Is our next featured author. Our next featured author is a song teller. And I am excited to hear her sing her story. This is Miss Dianne Bellamy Small. She is one of our current school board members, but also a very active member in our community. She has been an advocate for communities within our that serve our school district. She has a long history of standing and fighting for people in the community at many different levels, and it is an honor for her to come and share her story with us. I have gotten a beautiful preview of this story, and what is so nice is it is a story about how a teacher touched her life, and I cannot wait to hear her share this with each and every one of you. So enjoy. Thank you, Ms. Bellamy Small, for being here today.
Jumbo, my brothers and sisters. Jumbo. All right. Hello, how is everyone?
Good.
Okay. As Ms. Donson said, my name is T. Dianne Bellamy Small. And I am very proud to have the opportunity to come and share with you a part of my life. And part of the reason that I'm here with you today is because of a teacher. And when I use this book in training teachers, I try to help them understand the power that they have over a child's life. How many of you know who your special teacher is or was? Okay. So everybody had a teacher that perhaps made an impact in your lives. And for you young people, you know, it might not mean a lot to you now, but when you're probably half the age that I am, you know, you'll look back and say, she was tough on me. She made me do my work over and over again, but she made a difference in my life. Well, I actually like to go whenever I'm asked to come and be at schools, to go and talk to the fifth graders. And the reason is because this book, the story of this, happened around the time that I was getting ready to go to what was called then junior high school. Now you call it middle school. I did something that I wasn't supposed to do. Yeah, I did. I lied to my father. And let me tell you, young people, don't lie. It'll get you in trouble every time. Now, in my family, I am the oldest. And so, how many of you are the oldest in your family? Raise your hand. Okay, so you know that a lot is expected of the oldest, even whenever it's not expected of the younger ones. And so there were four of us. I had two sisters and a brother. My baby sister has now passed away. But I was the big mama. I was left at home to take care of my brother and sisters. And so one day, whenever we were there, I decided we were playing house. And so I got my daddy's switch and started chasing around my brothers and sisters. And an accident happened. I accidentally hit my baby sister in the face. Fortunately, she was wearing glasses, so I didn't hit her in the eye, but she had a welt up under her eye. Now I knew, we gotta do something, come up with something before daddy gets home. And in this book, I talk about what those things were. So my book is entitled, What I Will Teach You, and I'll get to that later. But there are four major things that this book is about. It's about ambition, it's about consequences. Now, for one of the young folks, who can tell me what is a consequence? Yes, sir.
A consequence is something that you do something wrong and you get punished for it.
Okay, that is a very good definition. And here's your gift, because consequences can be good things too. And so for you being brave enough to answer the question, You get a gift. How about that? You're welcome. Okay, so consequences. A love of music and a love of a teacher. That's what the main themes of this book is about. And so as I was telling you, I'm the oldest, and we live in Winston-Salem, right next door to Greensboro. And this particular day, we were playing house, and I hit my baby sister in the face. So she had a welt under her eye. So I had to figure out, as the oldest, what were we going to do? Because my dad got off from work. He worked for R.J. Reynolds, so he was a factory worker. And he got off at 4:15 exactly.
What's his?
So I knew that by 4:15, I'd better have something to tell my father about what had happened. So I convinced my younger brother and sisters to lie and to say that she failed. Now, when my father got home from work, we had a table where my sisters sat on one side, my brother sat on the other side. I sat at the direct opposite end from my father. So he had a direct line of sight to me. And so when we're sitting there, my father could tell that something was wrong. But let me tell you something about a group lie. It's called the weakest link. And usually there's one person in that group lie who's gonna fold before everybody else, right? So, my sister looked next to me, who was 2 years younger than myself. She didn't take a lot of care from her big sister anyway. So guess what she did? She told her. She told her. Okay, so as a result of that, there were consequences, as the young man said. And one of the consequences for me was that in elementary school, I played in the band, and I played the clarinet. And so my father, we couldn't afford a clarinet, so he had rented it from a pawn shop called Camel Pawn Shop. And they just closed that pawn shop after 93 years over in Winston-Salem. But my father had gone there, and $5 a week was a lot to pay for a clarinet or to rent something. So part of my punishment was that he took the clarinet back to the pawn shop and took me with him. And I'm sitting in the car crying because he was taking my clarinet back. Now, if you know anything about junior high school in the 1960s, and I went to segregated schools, who knows what segregated means? Yes, back in the back.
It was still racism going on?
Yeah, racism going on, but that's not exactly what segregated means. What does segregated mean? Yes, sir?
Like, were they
separated? Separated, yes, yes, here you go. You sure? Oh, you knew that was coming, didn't you? There you go, you welcome. Yes, in the 1960s, schools were still segregated. So black children went to school in one school, and white children went to school in other schools. So in the segregated school, in the school I went to, was a junior-senior high school. So they had from 7th grade to 12th grade in the same school building. But they had a marching band. One of the things that we knew about African-American schools of this era is that they had some of the best marching bands you ever heard of. How many of you are old enough to remember the movie Drumline? Okay, and you remember Drumline, man, those bands were smoking. That's how black high school bands were back in the day, as they would say. And so there were four black high schools in Winston-Salem: Atkins, Anderson, Paisley, and Carver. And I went to Paisley. Now, the best marching band was Atkins. Atkins had the best marching band. When Atkins' band would go out on the football field, there was no turf left when they left off of that field. That's how good they were. But I wanted to be in the marching band because it meant that other than athletes in the school, the folks who were in the marching band were the next level of you important in the school. And you got to wear a uniform, and you got to perform in parades and pep rallies and all those kind of things. So I wanted to be in the marching band, but My father taking my clarinet. So when I got to school and I went to the band teacher and I said to him, I don't have an instrument. And he said, well, I'm sorry, I don't have an instrument to give you. You're not gonna be able to be in the band. So he suggested to me that I go over into the auditorium, which is where the classroom was for the chorus class, and asked to sign up for chorus. So I did not want to do that. I was not a happy camper. So I went and hid in the bathroom for 2 hours and cried. But before I went back to class, I had to have something on that piece of paper saying where I had been. So I went into the auditorium, and on the stage, which is, if you know, in some of your older schools, you have a stage with curtains, and they have lights behind it, and then the auditorium part is out in the where people sit. But we were up on the stage. So I went into the auditorium, and I met Miss Roberts. And Miss Roberts was a nice lady. She wore a bun. Pull the hair back and put it in a bun. I guess that was the easiest thing to do early in the morning. Then she wore trifocals. Not bifocals, because you know bifocals just have two lenses. She wore trifocals, which had three lenses. And I used to think that the reason why teachers wore trifocals was so you wouldn't know which lens they were looking at you. I don't know. Whenever they would look at you, because they would look like this. Up and down. So she was trifocal. So I went into the auditorium and I said, Miss Roberts, Mr. Foy told me to come and ask you if I could be in the chorus. And I said to her, I said, he said you were a nice lady. And she said, he did. I said, yes, ma'am. So she said, okay. She said, can you sing? I said, yes, ma'am. I've been singing since I was 5 years old. And I was in Miss Sheffield's chorus in the sixth grade. And in order to be in Miss Sheffield's chorus in the sixth grade, you had to be something, right? So she says, all right. She vocalized me. You know what vocalized means? Somebody who's in music should know what vocalizing means. Vocalize. Anybody? Yes, ma'am. Okay, to practice, to vocalize, all right. I still have some more. You can come. I have one. Oh, and I have some for adults, too. But I have some adult questions that I'll ask a little bit later. There you go. All right, so she vocalized me, and so she said, She says, I think you'll make a good alto. Well, I was, a very shy kid, but I spoke up and said, well, but I was a soprano in Miss Sheffield's chorus. And she looked at me through those trifocals and she said, you're gonna be an alto in my chorus. Now, I wasn't happy particularly with that because all of a sudden now, telling my dad a lie had caused me to lose my clarinet, couldn't be in the marching band. I was now going to be in chorus, and I was going to be an alto. But that was the consequence of part of it. But I started watching this teacher and the way she taught class and her love for music and how she would make it come out of you and how she would take her time and talk to her students and tell them, I can get better sound out of you. And of course the student would look at her like, I don't think so. And she would say, sing! And you sang. So one day, I decided to go and ask her if I could do solos. Because I had been singing since I was 5. And I was, in chorus. So I went and she was on stage. She always took her lunch. Ate her lunch on stage at her piano. And so I went in and I said, Miss Roberts, can I ask you a question? And she looked at me and she put her chicken salad sandwich down and she said, yes. And so I asked her, and I'll start reading here. I went on the stage at lunchtime when she was alone. As usual, she was sitting at the piano finishing her chicken salad sandwich. So I decided to ask her a question. I said, "Ms. Rothers, can I ask you something?" She looked up over the piano. She was a short, attractive lady who wore a black wig sometimes. She had a twinkle in her eyes that said all the time, "I love music." She was a very spiritual woman. She waited for my question. With a bit of hesitation, I asked, "Can I do solos?" She responded, "You want to do solo work?" As I looked at her, I felt I had asked the wrong thing, but I quietly said, "Yes, ma'am." She looked straight at me and said, "But you don't have the voice." Then she paused as I looked over the top of the piano. Her answer hurt me at first. I wanted to run away. I said something wrong, I thought. When she told me that, I dropped my head and I stopped looking at her. She then stood and crossed her fingers. As she leaned forward across the top of the piano, she smiled. I raised my head just enough to look through my eyebrows at her as she, with a twinkle in her eye, I could see her looking through her trifold. Then she said, "But I will teach you." Then she quickly sat down on the bench that had a pillow on it that raised her up. She struck the key on the piano and said, "Sing ah!" I responded quickly by opening my mouth and I sang ah as loud as my heart of joy would let me. I was the happiest seventh grader at Paisley Junior Senior High School that day. I ran up to my best friend at the beginning of the next class and I told her that Ms. Roberts said that she would teach me. She said, "Girl, what are you talking about?" I said, "You don't understand." And I grinned. Every day, from that day forward, until I finished ninth grade, I worried this teacher every day, before school, after school, between classes, and she never turned me away. Sometimes she would say, "Dianne, I only have 15 minutes. And I took those 15 minutes. And then whenever I got to the ninth grade, I was not one of those students that got awards for good behavior. Not that I was a bad child, but I challenged authority. I guess that's why I'm an elected official now. because I always wanted to make sure that things were being done fair. And a lot of times when I challenged authority, it wasn't for me. It was for the benefit of others. One of the stories I like to tell is the fact that I used to be the person who stood between the bully and their victim. Now either I'm crazy, or it was because I believed that this victim needed someone to stand before him. And I never had to fight, because I guess the bullies thought, "She crazy enough to stand between me and my intended victim. She must could do something." But all I had to do was stand and say, "No, you're not gonna do that." And they would walk away. So when I got to the ninth grade, we always had an awards program. And at the end of the awards program, they would give special awards. So I wasn't even expecting this, but this teacher, Ms. Roberts, stood up and said, "I have a special award to give today. And it's to a student that I've never seen one like her before." And the writing on the award said, "Most ambitious." And that's what she said, that I was one of the most ambitious students that she had ever seen. So from that, she, of course, and we're going to sing today, the first solo I was taught was by her. It was a Negro spiritual entitled Ain't it that good news? And I've used that over the years, and I have been singing now for 60, well, since I was 5 and I'm 72, so y'all do the math. But that long. And it's still my signature song. A few weeks ago, I did a Black History program. Of course, you know I had to include Ain't That Good News. But I went on to go to governor's school. I was the first African-American vice president of governor's school in 1969. I went on to go to college, and I was a music major. And in fact, I just left before I came up here and went up to ACC because I did play basketball for the schools that I attended. So I played for Carolina. And probably if my life had taken a different direction, I would have been a PE teacher instead of a music major. But back in the 1970s, we did not have Title IX, so there were not scholarships for athletes, for women, for female athletes. Whereas I was able to get a full scholarship as a singer. And so the rest is history. I became a singer. And it has made all the difference in my life because as a very shy person, I don't think that if this teacher had not encouraged me, had not given me her time, I would have not been the person that I am today. What this story ends up with is that she does give me the award at in the ninth grade that said most outstanding, one of my prized possessions. And then in 1989, I did a concert in Big Old Spirit Fest. And I asked all of my music teachers, from the band teacher I had in sixth grade whenever I tried to play the clarinet, and I played it horrible, so I shouldn't have been playing the clarinet, to the chorus teacher, to my voice vocal teachers, all of my teachers, my chorus teacher in high school, I went to R.J. Reynolds and graduated in 1970, and I was the first Black president of the mass chorus for R.J. Reynolds. They all came. And this teacher was there. And so afterwards, she told me how proud she was of what I had become and wanted me to perform for her students. Because though she was retired, teachers never retire. They just kind of go to doing teaching in a different way. So she had organized a community choir. And she wanted me to come and perform for them. And so, of course I did, because to those of us that much is given, much is required. So when I went to do the performance for her students, I took a banner and a rose, and I told the kids this story. And she sat at the piano, and she listened to me, and she said, I don't remember that. And I told her that I do. And it's made all the difference in my life. And I got a chance to tell my teacher, thank you for making the difference in my life. And she died a year later of stomach cancer. But I am so glad that I had the opportunity to thank her. And that I represent her more than I represent myself, because I would not be the individual that I am today if it were not for the woman who said to me, I will teach you. That's my story. So now we're going to sing. Thank you, baby. I appreciate that. Instead of singing Ain't of That Christmas, I'll do that. But I want to teach you a Negro spiritual where we can sing as a group if you would like.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So now. I want the folks standing in the back, this is your part. Hush, hush. That's all you got to do. Let's hear it. Hush,
hush.
Oh, beautiful. Okay, now, I want the folks, yes, I might already know who we're singing. The folks who are sitting right here, you're going to sing, somebody's calling my name. That's all you're going to do, okay? Somebody's calling my name. Can you do it like you did at breakfast this morning? Somebody's calling my name. Okay, over here, you're gonna go, oh Lordy. Oh Lordy. One more time. Oh Lord. Okay, in the old Black Baptist Church, you always had, they didn't have organs and instruments. They used patting and clapping. So I want everybody to kind of get your pat on. There you go. Okay, and then I'm going to point to who comes first, and then I'll do the verse. We got that? I like that pat. Sounds good. Hush. Come on.
Hush.
There we go.
Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Hush.
Good.
Hush.
Good.
Somebody's calling my name. Oh, Lordy. Hush.
Good. Come on, give me some voice.
Hush.
There we go.
Somebody's calling my name.
Everybody.
Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. What shall I do? What shall I do?
Come on now. We at my grandmother's church. Come on now.
Hush.
Come on, come on, come on.
Hush.
Come on.
Somebody's calling my name.
Good.
Hush. Hush.
Good.
Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Hush. Hush.
Somebody's calling my name. Everybody. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. What shall I do?
What shall I do?
Woo!
Sounds like Jesus. Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Sounds like Jesus. Somebody's calling my name.
Oh,
good. Sounds like Jesus. Somebody's calling my name.
Everybody.
Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. What shall I do? What shall I do?
Hush.
There you go.
Hush.
Yes.
Somebody's calling my name.
Very good.
Hush. Hush. Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Hush.
Very good.
Hush. Somebody's calling my name.
Everybody.
Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. What shall I do? What shall I do? I'm so glad troubles don't last always.
Oh, Lordy.
I'm so glad troubles don't last always.
Oh, Lordy.
I'm so glad, Lord, troubles don't last always. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord, what shall I do? What shall I do?
Let's bring it on in. Come on.
Hush.
There you go.
Hush. Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Hush. Hush. Somebody's calling my name.
Oh, Lordy.
Hush.
There you go.
Hush. Somebody's calling my name.
Everybody.
Oh, my Lord, oh, my Lord, what shall I do? What shall I do?
All right.
Yes.
So thank you that my teacher taught me so that we can end this way. I got crowned up in that kingdom, ain't that good news? I got a crown up in that kingdom, ain't that good news? I'm gonna lay down this world, gonna shoulder off of my cross, gonna take it home to my Jesus, ain't that good news? I got a robe up in that kingdom, ain't that good news? I got a robe up in that kingdom. Ain't that good news?
I'm gonna lay down this world, gonna shoulder up my cross, gonna take it over to my Jesus. Ain't that good news? I got a Savior in that kingdom. Ain't that good news? I got a Savior in that kingdom. Ain't that good news? I'm gonna lay down this world, gonna shoulder up my cross, gonna take it home to my Jesus. Ain't that good news?
I have two gifts for adults. I need who is the oldest adult here if you want to say.
I'm 45.
I'm your age.
Okay. And this is the one picture that means the most, which is unity. Okay. And who knows what the what Kwanzaa stands for? An adult. What Kwanzaa stands for?
Natural word.
What?
Festival of Lights.
No, that's not nobody? Kwanzaa? I heard somebody say the feast?
Yeah.
The first feast, yes. Yes, there you go. All right. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Oh my goodness, that was amazing. Can we give Miss T. Dianne Bellamy Small a round of applause? Day. So you have until 2, we may give a little bit more time for you to finish getting your books reviewed, and then we will make sure every child has a book or two, a little birdie told me, before they leave. So enjoy the rest of your book tasting. Thank you for coming out today. This has truly been a pleasure spending the day with you. Enjoy your time.